and they all done drew all outside the line and they in the fifth grade and you look at them and tell them, that's so good, that ain't good. You in the fifth grade, you ought to know how to keep your letters inside the line. Amen, somebody. God is a good God. Get your Bibles because we are going to be processing through today. Hold the music. We're going to be processing through today's lesson and moving throughout every service. And I didn't know that I was going to be here this morning, and Sister Medina was supposed to be here, and she missed her flight. So I always say tagging it. So I told y'all know the tagging it. We tagged Bishop Tag and said, somebody told me I was it last night. And it wasn't funny no more. Because I was scheduled to do the 11 o'clock service and the 6 o'clock service. So now I'm 5, 8, 11, and 6 if she don't show up. So y'all pray my strength, because y'all know I don't do no 100 services a day like Bishop. I was telling somebody, I said, he just preached real hard, and he come back there and change his clothes and put his little bow tie on, and he be looking like, okay, I'm willing next. I said, I'd be looking at him like, are you on drugs or something? Because I know this is not easy. Amen, somebody. Well, if you take it, give me some of it. Because you just acting all like, wow, you know, time to go. So when Sister Lynn and Sister Rhonda came to get me this morning, they had that same little Bishop look like, morning. I was like, y'all need to calm down. Y'all too high. I need somebody to look a little sleepy or something like that with me. That's too high to jump. Morning, Mother. I was like, pull all that down. Pull all that in. Amen, somebody. But we here and we gonna do what the Lord has called us to do. Amen? Amen. Go with me to Numbers, the 20th chapter. The book of Numbers, the 20th chapter. We have several challenges. I done lost my glasses somewhere. So y'all just pray my strength. Numbers, the 20th chapter. And the reason why I'm going to start here is because I hit something the last time I ministered concerning this. And I don't believe that the Lord has yet turned it loose. And so in looking at our last lesson, we were talking about when you change your mindset, you change your direction. As long as you're headed in a past mindset or a mindset that is less than what God has called you to be and what God has called you to become, then you have no direct direction. You're just wandering and don't know where you're going. And so we're living in a time now where the manifestation and the evidence of the Holy Ghost, we are in a time now where it must be seen. It is mandatory that we exemplify the power of God. And I'm not talking about exemplifying the power of God just by being in church and praising God and jumping and shouting, because we're in a different age now. And so we have yelled and we have screamed and we have talked about the anointing of God and the power of God between the pews and in our churches. And now, if we don't move to the next level to bring forth the manifestation of the evidence of the power that we say we have, we are about to be made a mockery. The church is about to be made a mockery, because even now, you know, I always say, when you look out in the secular world, you see people doing things, I honestly think that it is an embarrassment almost when you see people that do not possess or do not claim to possess the Holy Ghost, and they don't talk about, you know, the power of God. And you look at the Brad Pitts and the Angelina Jolies and the Oprah Winfreys and the people like that feeding the hungry. And doing outreach, and the church is in the church having church. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me now. The church is in the church having church, and the world is in the world doing the works of the kingdom. And so we cannot become judgmental about what we see until we learn to do what God has called us to do. When you look at the book of James, it says it doesn't matter about people saying, you know, I got faith in God and I love God, and God is my all in all, and he is just, you know, ain't nobody gonna take my Jesus away from me. But the book of James says, when you show me a person's works, when you show me a person in action, when you show me a person that have movement, then you're showing me a person that possess faith. Amen's is low right there. You are showing me a person that possess faith. And so the reason why there is no movement, and we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about, the whole movement aspect. The reason why there's no movement in the kingdom of God is because we don't understand what our purpose is, because it's almost like a child that starts out in grade school and kindergarten. You know, you can't be 10 years old still in grade school. And so out of the fear of people losing membership, and out of the fear of people that leave, and out of the fear of people being offended, we don't really tell people the truth. You know, just like when I came in here today and I said, you know, I feel stuff a little low in here. We don't really tell people the truth. And that's how we keep people in kindergarten. Not gonna get no amens right there. That's why we can't grow up. We can't grow up because we won't go beyond and not teach people where they are, but teach people into their next level. And see, if I just come in here and I just say, well, you know what? And God is good, and praise God, and you know, and y'all, we just gonna love God, and we just gonna this, and we just gonna that. Nobody wouldn't grow. And we'll just be around here jumping and shouting and praising God, and we still haven't changed. We have no character. We have no movement, because we cannot keep the body of Christ in the area of clean it up, get it right, put it down, don't touch it, all of that, because we've been there for years, and we've been there too long. It's almost going through. Come on, we left Egypt, but we never made it to Canaan. We stayed in the wilderness too long. Somebody say too long.
Too long.
Somebody say it again, too long.
Too long.
So when you look at this in the Numbers, the 20th chapter, you're going to see something that is very, very profound today. And I'll continue this in the 8 o'clock service. You're going to see something that's very profound in this. It says in the 20th chapter and around the 7th verse, and it says, and the Lord said to Moses, take the rod and assemble the congregation, you and Aaron, your brother, and tell the rock before their eyes to give forth its water. And you shall bring forth to them water out of the rock. So you shall give the congregation and their livestock drink. Now I want you to see the pattern here. Let's go back and read it again. Take the rod and assemble the congregation. Take the rod and assemble the congregation. Take the rod and assemble the congregation. Why was he asking him to take the rod and assemble the congregation? Because when you look at it, it was the rod. Now watch this. It was the rod when they left Egypt and they got to the Red Sea. And so, you know, it was the rod that he went to Pharaoh, and he threw his rod down. And so the people began to understand that there was some kind of power that God had established in that rod. And so what he was trying to do is say to them, I don't want you to present anything else to them but the manifestation of what I have the ability to do. So take what they know to be the power of God and gather them. Maybe that's the reason why we can't get the sinner man to come to church. Maybe that's why we're not really having real church growth. Can I stop and talk about that right quick? Real church growth. Real church growth. I'm not talking about recycling membership. Because if I were to ask everybody in here, brother, to raise their hand. Somebody in here, the majority, 95% of the people that are in this building today came from somebody else's church. They didn't come from the streets. They're not alcoholics and prostitutes and people that stuck on crack and people that's got AIDS. We have not had church evangelism in years. We're just recycling people. And the reason why we're recycling people people is because we don't have nothing to lay before somebody that says, come and let me draw you. We don't have a drawing card. Oh, come on, somebody. What is your drawing card? What is your drawing card? Why don't we have a drawing card? We don't have a drawing card because we won't stand still long enough for God to do anything for us, because as soon as we start going through a trial, we start whining. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Come on, calm down, because I got to teach you this. I got to teach you. We won't process through the problem. The reason why the children of Israel were great, and the reason why they were classified as something that was monumental that stayed before us, is because they had a wilderness experience. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Why do we have the Bible? Why is the Old Testament important? It's important because testament. What is a testament? A testament is the life and the experience of somebody who have died and have left their story, still lives. You can't have a testimony until something dies. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. You're not saying nothing. You're not saying nothing. Because see, the Bible says in the book of let me just go to Peter. Go to Peter right quick. I wanna take us here. I'm gonna just ooh. Oh, this is gonna really help you. No, that's not what I want. I want Hebrews, because I want to show you something. Hebrews 11 chapter, and the second verse, Hebrews 11:2. For by faith, trust, and holy fervor, born of faith, the men of old had divine testimony, born to them, and obtained a good report. Now, when you look up that word, man of God, born, I can think of about five definitions off the top of my head from my computer. Born means, B-O-R-N-E, B-O-R-N-E, to have the ability to carry, to have the ability to be supported, to have the ability to carry from one place to the next, to be upheld. Y'all ain't saying nothing. To establish, to be able to reproduce. Y'all ain't saying nothing. To have the ability to reproduce. What am I talking about when I say have the ability? In other words, Elijah's testimony was so powerful, and his life was so powerful, that it reproduced a Juanita Bynum. It established the prophetic anointing in the earth realm because he finished his course. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Who's coming behind you? And the reason why can't nobody come behind us, because we can't find your pattern. Because you won't be still. You won't be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord. We can't find your testimony. Because one minute you in church, the next minute you out. One week y'all on fire and coming to prayer with three overflow rooms. And this week you got empty chairs, because we can't track you. God, I don't hear nobody talking to me right there. No consistency. Jesus didn't come here as Jesus. And sometimes he was the devil. He maintained his position as Jesus until he was transferred to the Christ. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Whoa, okay. That right there. He maintained his position as Jesus until he was transferred to the Christ. Y'all ain't saying nothing. So he didn't get to the Christ and become the Christ and lost the testimony as Jesus. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. I can't just be Juanita Bynum. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I can't just be Juanita Bynum. If I lose the testimony of Juanita, then I have no right to attach prophetess Juanita Bynum to my title. The fact Okay, sit down. Let me just. We shake too much. Shake too much. No identification. Unbalanced. Okay. Always need somebody to pamper you. Unbalanced. And I keep trying to tell y'all all the time, trials ain't going nowhere. Tribulations are not going anywhere. Persecution is going to be here. So if you're waiting, you don't understand what I'm going through, I'll just be glad when it's over. When that's over, something else is coming. God, I don't hear nobody hardly talking to me. Something else is coming. Something else is coming. At least you got a handle on the devil that you're dealing with, because something else is coming. You're not getting ready to be devil free. You're not getting ready to be warfare free. Just because you have a prayer life don't mean trials is going nowhere. Oh, y'all, come on. Let me just do this. See, we talk about that, then we have to look at the fact that it says that they obtained a divine testimony born to them and obtained a good report. Now, I want you to see something. When you look at the word integrity, and I got to just break that down for a minute. Look at the word integrity. We don't really understand what that means. It's like I look at my ministry now, and it's like I've, you know, been in ministry now for over 25 years, and so then I celebrated last year 25 years of ministry, more than 11 years of international and worldwide ministry. And so the fact remains is it's not hard to get here. It's not hard to become famous. It's not hard, you know, you know how to put some graphics together and take a cute picture, you know, get a few connections and give some big preachers some big seeds and all that, and they'll put you on TV and all that. It ain't hard to get here. See, you can get the hookup and get here. All you gotta do is be in the right place at the right time. And your girlfriend, uncle, is a big time preacher, and he best friends with Benny Hinn. You go on one show, and that's it. You already to the nation. It's not hard to get here. It's hard to stay here. Because, see, you can ride in on somebody else's name, but you got to stay on your own. Oh, I'm going to take my time and teach this today. Oh, you can get in on somebody else's merit. But, see, the fact remains is that if you get in because you are a pretender and an imitator, and you have not really been purged out in God, you can only act for so long. A movie don't last forever. When the part is over, it's over. They done paid you already. You're going to have to pull the mask off, and after a while, they're going to see you for who you are. Come on, y'all, sit down, because I got to teach this. Sit down, because we got people in the body of Christ right now, right in this ministry, where every time they turn around, where mother, every time she come, and every time she get up, she talking about living right, she talking about purging right, because you're not going anywhere, because you will never last if you don't have it. And every time I see signs of all of this lackadaisicalness in the spirit realm, every time I see signs that makes it look like you can relax and cross your legs and get away with this and get away with that, I have to keep attacking it. Okay, sit down. Let me say this. I gotta read you this. Everybody just sitting there, just shaking their head like, See, when the Lord have designed that your breakthrough, your miracle, what God is going to do for you, your destination, see, you can't be like everybody else. Because your breakthrough is coming through the fact that he has placed you under a ministry that is declaring that you live right. So I don't care who gets theirs the other way. Yours will never come if you don't get right. Because yours is coming in on the handle of righteousness. So every time you mess up, you backtrack yourself. Every time you slip and do something that you ain't got no business doing, you backtrack yourself. Every time you decide that you don't want to come to prayer, you set yourself back. Okay, sit down. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Come on, some of y'all don't even know what this feels like today. You don't even know what this feels like today. It's almost like you beat a child, and you beat a child, and you say, didn't I tell you, and I mean don't touch it no more, and I mean don't touch it. And then you go away somewhere, and you come back, and they acting just like you ain't never said don't touch it. Almost a year and a half, I've been doing 5 a.m. prayer and saying purge, and then you come back, and everybody looking like, what? Because you know what? The reason why is because we have not been established in the power of integrity. Listen. We are not going to be the kind of congregation that swings off the spirit realm and swings off of shouting and swings off of church and swings off of power. And oh, we had a powerful time, but we're not moving. The children of Israel had some powerful moments in the wilderness, but something happened and it stopped the church from moving. Okay, sit down. Let me just say that. Let me just say that. They left Egypt. Had time. Oh, look at God. Got in the wilderness. You know, shoes didn't wear out. Got hungry. Okay, that was a little bit of immaturity there when they got hungry. God said, okay, manna from heaven. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I ain't saying nothing. Moses goes up because they halfway there. And he goes up because he needed to hear from God. And what they do, build a golden calf. Y'all ain't saying nothing. See, the part that made God mad is that it was God that brought them out of Egypt. And now you're going to get all the way here and want to put your eyesight on something else. Now before you trust me, I got to show you something. Oh, I'm not hearing y'all talk about it. Oh, now you got to see a sign. When if it wasn't for the presence of the Lord, you wouldn't even be here today. A lot of y'all ought to have been committed suicide. Now God is requiring that you get up and go on into your destiny. And now he got to show you something. Oh, y'all sit down. I done caused a rod to lick up snakes. Y'all ain't saying that. I done spoke out of a burning bush. I done let a whole nation of people walk out of Egypt. I done brought you across the Red Sea on dry land. And now you get out here talking about, God showed me a sign. I'm not showing you no more signs. Because the kind of people that's about to experience a breakthrough is the people that's going to take him at his word and live right. Sit down, because I can't go way out there too quick, because I got too far to go. People that's gonna take him at his word. And so now we in the hour where the cover's being snatched off. Now we in the hour where the pacifier is gone. Oh, come on. See, now we in the hour where we find out who's here for God and who's here for prophetess Bynum. Because when we don't see prophetess, then we don't come. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. But the next level is after the people that says, I don't care who come. I'm coming because God is birthing consistency in me, because I got to stand up in one place. I shall not be moved, having done all to stand. Sit down. Let me do this. Come on, You better shake your spirit. You better shake your spirit before you lose your breakthrough. You better shake your spirit before you can't track yourself. You better shake your spirit before you get lost in the wilderness. I'm preaching to somebody right now. You're about to lose your foothold. You're about to lose direction. You better put God back on the throne. You better tell God, do it all over again in me. God. Oh, Jesus. Okay, sit down. Let me just say this. Integrity. Listen, the dictionary says integrity, soundness. Oh, y'all. Yeah. Well, you prophets, you don't even know what's been happening to me. You don't even know what I've been going through. No. Alice Jones' husband was a pastor, and he had a major stroke and had surgeries on his brain. Soundness. But see, oh, y'all ain't saying that. She started out as the pastor's wife and just assisting him. Now she's had to take over the responsibility of the church. But every time you see this woman, you see soundness. I'm not hearing y'all talk, because see what y'all are waiting for. You're waiting for your troubles to disappear before you get sound. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. You're going to have to find the anointing of the spirit of integrity no matter what you're going through. I don't care what the devil do. You got to make up in your mind. I've been called to a place, and this is the place that I'm going to get my breakthrough. And I do understand that the devil knows that too. And that's why he will send everything he can possibly think of trying to move me, because he knows I'm on my way somewhere. Touch three people and said, I shall not be moved. No, y'all ain't saying it like you mean that. You ain't saying it like you mean it. I said, touch three people and said, I shall not be moved. I said, touch somebody else and said, I shall not be moved. Come on, tell them, I shall not be moved. Oh, y'all, sit down. And just sit down. I'm moving. The word of the Lord, watch this. The word of the Lord, because Jesus remained Jesus when the storm came. And the Bible didn't say he ran and grabbed the hold to the side of the ship and started, oh God, we're gonna die. There's a storm out here. Oh my God. Oh, I'm gonna jump and kill myself. The Bible said he was asleep. And woke up in the middle of a storm and said, peace, be still. No, you don't understand what I'm trying to say. I'm not hearing nobody getting what I'm trying to tell you. Oh, Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Lord, see, how do you know? How do you know when you're the word? How do you know when you're the word? How do you know when you're the word person? Because the word person is the person that's been called to encounter the storm. I'm not hearing y'all. You think the storm is coming because the devil is after you. But the storm is coming because God wants you to open up your mouth and let what's in your belly come out and govern your atmosphere and dictate to your atmosphere and tell your atmosphere what it's going to be like. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Sit down. Let me just say this. Okay, I'm finna show you. Integrity is the firm adherence to a code or a standard of values. So when you are integral, you have a strong adherence, adhesiveness, stuck to it, band-aid. I ain't talking about these band-aids they make now, because these ain't real band-aids. When we was growing up, you had them band-aids that almost peeled the living skin off you. You can take a bath with them old band-aids. Them band-aids ain't going nowhere. As a matter of fact, it feel like when it get wet, it turn into some kind of rubber cement. See, the old Band-Aids, you had to get one of your sisters to hold your hand when it was time to change that Band-Aid. Because you'd be stretching out like somebody's cutting you with a knife and pouring alcohol in it at the same time. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And so see, that's what's wrong. We ain't got the right stuff in front of us for us to get the right idea. And that's why we stuck on the modern day Band-Aid. The one that slip off. The one that as soon as you sweat, it peel up. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You don't have the concept of what the word adherence means and adhesiveness, because you ain't been, listen, y'all babies, anybody that's 40 or older, you got to understand what a real Band-Aid is. So when somebody tell you to stick to it, come on somebody, you got a real mental concept of what they're talking about. The young generation, everything is microwave. Baby, back then, everything was the stove and the oven, and we had to wait on a meal. That's why the meal tastes better than they do now. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. So then the new generations, they don't know nothing about it being good, because to them it tastes good. Have you ever heard people say, my mama can cook, or my daddy, my sister them can cook. And you go and say, somebody told me the other day, I make a good banana pudding. So they was giving me their little recipe. I get the can, the carnation, and I was looking at them like, because my sister's 50 years old. She's been making a banana pudding ever since she was about 15. She bust the eggs and stir over that custard. Man, that ain't no canned stuff. Y'all ain't say, and that's why by the time the banana pudding come out the oven, everybody's standing on with a spoon. Now you want to start a fight in an African-American house? Put some banana pudding in the cup and stick it in the back of the refrigerator with aluminum foil on it and somebody eat it. Baby, that's a mess right there. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me today, church. Where the church at? And see, listen. The reason why something like that is a mess is because they know we can't bust another can of carnation open and just make some cookies and get some bananas. They know that banana pudding took time. That was the real deal. And she ain't gonna make no more until the next holiday. And I'm gonna knock your head off for eating my banana pudding. See, that's what I'm trying to get y'all to understand. That's why you got an old-fashioned pastor. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Y'all ain't gonna make me get modernized in my preaching. Come over here, somebody, because you got to learn how to value what's coming across this pulpit, because you got to understand, I can't let nobody trick me. I can't let nobody make me lose what mother and father are putting in me, because you know what? It took them too long to get this anointing. It took them too long to birth this thing in us. Who am I talking to right now? Get a chance to finish this, so y'all may have to go up and line up again and start all over again at 8 o'clock service. It says integrity, the quality of being undivided. The quality of being undivided. It said completeness. Complete. I'm not hearing y'all right there, because see something right there. Undivided. It's a quality. Now, in the dictionary, when it starts giving these definitions, it doesn't say, now watch this, y'all. Now this gonna help you. It doesn't say in the Webster's dictionary, to pray, to be sound, to ask the Lord for a firm adherence, a standard of values. It doesn't say, preacher, to pray until you get the quality of being undivided and complete. Do you know why Webster's dictionary was made? It was made universally for the world. It wasn't created based upon your religious beliefs. So what Webster is trying to tell you, that's not a prayer decision, that is a decision. In other words, a banker out there can make up in his mind that he's going to stick to the rules, and he's going to be complete in his thought. He's going to be undivided, and he don't even have the Holy Ghost. Oh, I just said something. just said something. Now I just said something right there. Because see, we Sister Jones, we done got all twisted. Holy Ghost, help me. Just help me to be help me to be sound. Holy Ghost, help me to. Yeah, okay, all right. Cause y'all looking at me like, okay. Holy Ghost, just help me to be sound. You just pray for me, cause I'm just praying to God. Just give me a standard of that. No. When you are presented with something that you 150% believe in. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Now let me bring it on home. Let's just take Lynn Baker, for example. Now, I know she's going to fall out because I'm using her. Now, Lynn Baker been telling me ever since I met her, Mother, I'm going to cut my hair. I want a new look. I want to cut my hair, Mother. I just want something that's just different because I'm tired of the ponytail. And every time Lynn go to the beauty shop to get her hair cut, she come back and said, Mother, I cut my hair. But then 3 days later, she finds some kind of way to get a scrunchie and make a ponytail. Do you know why? That it don't matter how many times she get it cut. In her mind, she thinks she getting it cut. But there's something that she values about that ponytail that I don't care. I don't care what that person say. You're not going to cut it short enough for me to snatch it up and grab it. See, the reason why she's been holding on to the scrunchies for years, and she won't let the scrunchie go, because she has a conviction that this is easier for me. I can manage this. I can have y'all ain't saying nothing. See, anybody gonna talk to me right there? Ain't nobody saying nothing right there. Lynn don't get up and pray and say, well, Lord, I'm going to the beauty shop. Now, should I get a ponytail or not? It's not a prayer thing. She's decided already that I don't want a haircut that's not gonna allow me to be able to make a ponytail. I'm not hearing y'all talk about it. Can I throw this ball back at you? See, that's what we gotta come to in our life with God. Touch nothing that's going to cause me not to be able to make a spiritual ponytail. I don't want to touch nothing that's going to make me lose the ability to grab a hope to what I know that I'm confident in. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. That's why I know you don't believe in your salvation. You don't believe in the power of God. Stop playing church. You don't believe in salvation. Stop playing church. You don't want to be saved. Because if you did, you wouldn't touch nothing. See, sit down. See, that ponytail is Lynn's security. You know, Lynn got two boys. She knows she can jump up at the last minute. She 80 pounds wet. That's a 2-second shower. She don't have to worry about how to gain weight, because everything she wears too big. So she don't have to worry about, you know, oh, I got to get up and I got to put this on, and I wonder if this going to fit and that going to fit. It's automatic. It's out the bed, a shower. And first of all, she frugal, so she ain't going to hardly spend no money. So that's why you're going to see in the same little skirt, same little pants, same little sandals, same little tennis shoes. That's why sometimes I just say, Lynn, take this back to the store for me when I buy stuff and I don't like it. I said, take it. I said, and buy yourself something. You ain't got to get the change. I'm trying to throw you a hint. Let me see something new, please. This is Lynn Baker right here. But that ponytail is her security. It's what she can depend on. It started raining. Lynn got baby soft hair. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Her hair is sensitive. It's sensitive to the weather that she lives in. So that's her security, because when it gets damp outside and the storm comes, everybody else's hair will hold up. But the minute the heat comes, hers fall. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You get the picture. Your salvation is sensitive. Yeah.
learn how to protect it. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You can't take it around certain stuff. Y'all ain't saying. And when you know that the weather gonna get bad, you gotta put some extra hairspray on it. You gotta put some extra protection. You can't ride down the street with the window down. You can't ride your life through your circumstance with your spirit unguarded, with your guards down. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me, because if you do, you gonna lose your hairstyle. You gonna lose the way you look. You gonna start looking crazy. You gonna start looking like you need the beauty shot. You gonna start looking like you need the Holy Ghost all over again.
Y'all ain't saying that. I ain't get nobody to say that. Ain't get nobody to say that. Ain't get nobody to say that. Looking like you need a spiritual hairdresser. Because you turned around and you let somebody cut your security like Samson. You laid your head in the wrong lap. And now you done got your power cut off. And you like Samson when he jumped up and shook and didn't have nothing. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Because I'm getting ready to put y'all on a one-day consecration. On a one-day consecration. From the time I lay this microphone down in the 5 a.m. prayer, you start praying. And you pray all the way to the 6 o'clock service. Because you got to get, listen, you got to go and grind the meal. Till you get your power back. Oh, y'all, come on, Susan. I can't even go to the... I can't... Psalms 41, and I'll pick it up in the next service. Psalms 41. Ooh. No movement. Psalms 41 and 12, and he says, go to the 10th verse. But you, O Lord, be merciful and gracious to me, and raise me up that I may requite them. By this I know that you favor and delight in me, because my enemy does not triumph over me. Y'all ain't saying that. I'm gonna have to stop saying that, because y'all really ain't. Y'all don't be saying that. Why did that touch your neighbor? Tell anybody got favor? I got favor, and the favor of the Lord's about. No, it's not. Because your enemy keeps triumphing over you. You keep getting bust upside your head down to the white meat by your own enemy. Okay. It keeps triumphing over you. It keeps making you act out. It keeps shaking you out of the will of God. It keeps convincing you to go another way. It keeps encouraging you to choose another God. I'm not hearing y'all saying nothing. Lord, where is the church at? Where was the church at? And as long as that happened, you don't have the favor of God. Okay, it says here in the 12th verse, and as for me, you have upheld me in my integrity. You have upheld me. In my integrity, you have upheld me in my integrity. I lost my integrity, so you didn't hold me. Y'all, see, everybody didn't get what I just said. I lost my soundness, my firm adherence to stick to the code of righteousness. I am integral when I stick to the code. And I become undivided in my walk with God. Then I am upheld in my integrity. Y'all ain't saying that. Now watch this. Let me break it down real quick. That means this. If integrity is soundness,
it's the ability to be undivided and complete. If integrity means, watch this, if integrity means the ability to walk and maintain a standard and a code, when I become integral, then he upholds me in what I have already made the decision to become. He doesn't make the decision for me. He can't hold me up in my righteousness until I decide to be righteous. Now, we ain't gonna get no whole lot of shouting today. Come on now, you're gonna have to run outside and line up again. It's almost over. We're going to a big enough building where I can beat all y'all at the same time, but I'm sorry, it's got to be 2 or 3 whoopings in one day. You have to decide. Now, watch this. I'm going to uphold you in your integrity. Why? Watch this. Why am I going to be upheld in my integrity? He said, by this I know. He said, and as for me, you have upheld me in my integrity and set me in your presence forever, and set me in your presence forever. You have set me in a quandary of a spirit realm. I'm like the boy in the bubble. Can't nothing get at me because I've been protected by a bubble. And so a lot of stuff that's getting at me should not have ever been able to get at me if I had walked in integrity. Because when I walk in integrity, you set me over in your presence. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And what can break the shield of the presence of God? Because the book of Galatians says that when the Lord says, what does he mean by his presence? He doesn't mean goosebumps. That's not tongues. That's not jumping and shouting and carrying on and all of that. Okay. 8 o'clock service. Okay. Right quick. Pastor Evan, don't tell. Right quick. You know, he'll walk on up and tell Bishop Wells he was a little late. You know, that's his partner. He ain't gonna lie to him. So I got to read this really fast like tongues. It says he's upheld me and set me in his presence. My integrity merited me the right to be forever set in his presence. Forever. My integrity did that for me. This is the place where there is no backsliding. This is the place where there is no slipping, there's no sliding, there's no oops and bleeps and blunders and oops, I made another mistake. It cancels that out of your life. You're the person now that can get on to the assignment, to the purpose that you were born for. You were not born just to spend the rest of your life travailing through a sloppy, agape walk with God. You got to come on and get yourself to the place that you can walk in righteousness till you can obtain the purpose that God put you in the earth realm. Out here and y'all talk back to me. See, it's too low right there. That's too low. Because it says here, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work, the fruit, Galatians 5 and 22, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which his presence within accomplishes. It ain't goosebumps. There's a job that the presence accomplishes. Now here we go. When I become integral, when I decide, when I become undivided about the fact that I want to live right, then the Lord picks me up. He upholds me in my integrity. He sets me in his presence because there is a work then that the presence accomplished, which means I don't have to pray for love. I don't have to pray for humility. It comes with the presence. I don't have to pray that God help me to be kind, that God help me to treat my neighbor right. It comes engulfed in the presence. I don't have to pray that I'm even tempered. I don't have to pray that God give me joy. I don't have to seek him for patience. It comes with the presence of the Lord. When I decide to be integral, he will pick me up and set me over into his nature. Then I can accomplish. now I understand why y'all look at me like that. Because y'all thought the Lord was going to do it. You just got knocked upside your head because you thought your lack of patience and you thought your temper was going to be something God was going to help you with. Mm-mm. You don't come to that until you get integral about what you believe God has called you to become. Then he picks you up and he sits you over into the atmosphere where the atmosphere in you accomplishes those things. Where then, brother, you see somebody that you know you should have knocked their head off and said, I ain't even hit him. Lord, I'm shocked. But I don't even cuss out. I don't cuss no more. It's been 2 days since I had a cigarette. Where did it go? Oh, my God. Jesus. Oh, Lord, I didn't throw nothing. My kids is fighting, and all I said was, y'all cut that out and go sit down somewhere. I didn't go off. Okay, let me bring it on home. My husband made me mad, and I just said, all is well. I done messed around and got in the presence. Oh, my God. And everybody around me better thank God that he done put me in the presence. I done messed around and got integral because the things I used to do,